Well, good morning, everybody, and thanks for joining us. Just like last month, I have a mic. There are no speakers here. It's for our recording, so just ignore the mic. My name's Marissa Blackburn. If you don't know me, I am the Environmental Education Manager here with Cape Fear River Watch, and I coordinate our first Saturday seminar series, so thank you for coming. Just a couple announcements that I'm going to share before we get started, Riverwatch related. So we have a couple events coming up. It's starting to be our busy season as the weather is warming. It's getting to be springtime. Next Saturday, we're going to have our second Saturday cleanup. We will be cleaning up along Medical Center Drive around the Greenfield Lake watershed. So feel free to join us if you are available. We get started at 9 a.m. The following week is Creek Week, New Hanover County Creek Week, which is it's the inaugural Creek Week this year. We're starting it. And we're partnering with a couple different agencies around the county to do that. And our intern, Katie Clay, in the back there, our public health intern, will be doing a lunch and learn presentation here at the office at 12 o'clock on Wednesday, March 15th. On proper protocol for medication disposal and how improperly disposed of medication can have some negative environmental and human health impacts. So feel free to join us for that. It's gonna be a lunchtime, lunch and learn, bring your own lunch and enjoy and learn a little bit. We are still promoting the Medic Solo Wilderness First Aid course. If you know anybody or you are interested in attending, it's gonna be a 2-day intensive workshop where you learn how to save people when there are not first responders readily available to help. So Kemp, our riverkeeper, will be at that training. And that is on the third Saturday of the month. So because Kemp's gonna be there, we are not actually gonna be doing our third Saturday paddle series on the third Saturday. We will be starting it this month, but we're pushing to the fourth Saturday. So if you do wanna join us for our paddle series that we're gonna be starting back up, we will be doing that on the 25th. And we'll be paddling a stretch of the Black River. So if you're interested in signing up, you can talk to me or our new staff member, Shauna Jobe. So Shauna is in the front here. She's our new outreach and engagement manager. Replacing Audrey, for those of you guys that met Audrey. And we're super excited to have Shauna here with us. I think it's like second week number two. So say hello after, introduce yourself. We would love for you all to meet her. We also have an eco tour. We're doing our spring eco tour series. So our March eco tour is gonna be on Tuesday, March 21st at 10 a.m. over at Greenfield Lake. It'll be an hour long walk, join us for that. And then I just wanted to point out our board members that have come today. So Larry in the front here, if you could raise your hand, and then Paul as well over here in the middle area. So I'm gonna go ahead and stop talking. I'm gonna turn it over to Steve Dial, who's going to introduce our speaker for today.
Good morning, I'm Steve Dial with Dial Cordy & Associates, local marine biologist here. I wanted to introduce the master of ceremonies here, James Hargrove, and tell you a little bit about him. Our first knew James as a grad student at UNCW's Marine Lab. We followed him, we followed his growth. And of course, I'm good friends with Troy and Martin, and of course, Larry knows him. But I've known James probably since around, I think probably 2008, somewhere in there.
Somewhere around there.
And I forget what year you graduated.
Probably 10.
Okay, yeah, and then we hired him as a part-time biologist. At the time, we were working for NOAA in the Gulf of Mexico, Deepwater Horizon, and we needed lots of bodies to send over there for all the assessment work for NOAA. So James agreed to go over there for a couple of years. He worked part-time for us, and then we eventually hired him, and part of it's because his love for the outdoors. There isn't anything he can't do outdoors. Mm-hmm. Great person, marine biologist. He worked for us till about, 2000? Full-time till what, 2015, somewhere there?
Well, as a contractor to the 2015, yeah.
And then worked full-time to us, with us, and then, what year did you start Middle Sound then,
2016 is when we formed the LLC, but we didn't really start farming until around,
right.
It was 2018, right before Florence. A week before Florence, we had our first harvest, and then.
So after that, his love for the outdoors, his love for oysters, his love for, working with people and being out there so much was exciting for me to watch his growth and maturation as a business owner and as a fellow business owner. James still works with us on the river part-time, but I'm really proud of what he's done with his company and the growth of this company and his love for all things oysters. James is a great person, good family man, and as you can see here. Mm-hmm. And my job is to hold Hunter while he talks. So I may have some syrup and pancakes over on top of me before we get done.
Some pancakes, buddy? You good, Mr. Dow?
But let me go ahead. Here you go, James.
Thank you
James
very much.
Hargrove.
Yeah, thank you for the excellent introduction, Steve.
And do you have a mic on you? So
yeah, I was going to put this down.
Do you want me to play this video for you?
Yeah.
Okay. All right.
Fondness for oysters started at UNCW probably when I first started working with Troy Alphen in the benthic ecology lab. That was around 2010, I believe, spring of 2010. And from there, the love grew and appreciation grew. I came from Charlotte area, a little town called Lincolnton. And, there's hardly any seafood there. You get catfish and stuff like that. And we caught bluegill all the time, that sort of thing. But, made it to the coast in 2009 and have decided Wilmington's my home. So we're staying here. So when I first started at the lab, I kind of watched the industry as a scientist, essentially, and sort of saw that there was a lot of potential and basically nothing. No farms were in it. There were a few farms in existence, but the industry was in its infancy. And so I was like, there's a huge potential here. And me and a friend, a colleague who also worked for Steve, Keith Walls, Fallen Tide Farms, he ended up jumping into farming full time, I think before I did, and ended up, he's still going at it now. He's probably one of the top producers in Stump Sound. The interesting thing that I kind of look at it is like, so I'm an oyster biologist, oyster scientist, marine scientist, estuarine ecologist, whatever you want to call it. And you would think that somebody who has the background and knowledge in the oyster industry and ecology would have no problem getting a lease from the state. However, that turned out not to be the case. And interestingly, myself and a couple other growers who were applying for leases and sort of poking holes in the application process and asking too many questions and then getting regulations on us the following season caused probably a windstorm of regulations to come a part of the application process now. One of which was the one-third the width of the water body rule that was not existent. Used to be you could go put a lease essentially anywhere, back a post right up against the marsh, and you could essentially block a creek is their thinking. And so the idea is if you have a lease that has to be less than one-third the width of a water body, that way it would allow passing of boats and things like that because there's plenty of user conflict and more user conflict, especially around here, than there is maybe a little bit north in the Pamlico. So that was one of the regulations that was really challenging to deal with because although the thought process is sound, you don't want to block things off, it also forces all the growers that would have been back in a creek out of the way, out of sight, out into the forefront and into the areas where there's even more traffic because most of the places that we had typically were looking at were far in the back of a creek where typically nobody's going to go, or at least if they are going to go, it's going to be a shallow draft boat or a kayaker. I digress on that situation. So Middle Sound Mariculture, my company, Middle Sound, just up the road from here. My first lease application was 8 months long in process and was denied after that 8 months because of what's called a submerged land claim, which if you don't know what that is, neither did I. You would think North Carolina is a public trust state, so what the heck is a submerged land claim? Submerged land claim is supposed to be a grant from the King of England that you got continuity of documentation from when the King granted it to present day, which is kind of a rare thing, but they do exist. That's the notion. But if you have enough money, you can typically finagle your way into it, which happened to another grower in Masonboro Sound. We were denied with that Middle Sound lease because of the submerged land claim. It turns out that Figure Eight Island owns, the Homeowners Association owns the entire, essentially from the back of Figure Eight Island all the way to the ICW on both sides of the bridge, all past Figure Eight. And it'll be probably in perpetuity. I don't think they're ever going to get rid of it. And that came about from a railroad tycoon purchasing that from an educational, I can't remember what it's called, educational purchase back in the 50s, I think. 20s, school board thing. So that, well, I don't know. They were raising money, and who knows? And the guy had lots of money to spend, so he's like, I'll buy this marsh. Who cares? Give it to the state. But so that was a very challenging time thinking about, okay, this is 8 months into this process where I'm thinking I'm going to get ready to start growing oysters soon. Instead of the state saying, oh, well, it turns out that instead of just denying your lease because of the submerged land claim, because we all work under the same, in the same building and we know what a submerged land claim is, we're going to wait 8 months and then I'm going to peek my head over the cubicle and say, oh, by the way, you can't get this lease there because of a submerged land claim. So really frustrating. That was lease number one. At that point, I realized, okay, we got to approach this differently because it took 8 months. I can't just apply for one place. So I took the shotgun approach. I'm going to apply for five places, and we're going to submit all of them at once, and there's going to be one that goes through for sure. And ended up that a couple of them went through. So that's how Middle Sound Mariculture, we got our name, is because we originally applied there, and that's we got the LLC, and then the time frame, it just drug on and on and on, so we were prepared. And then after we got denied, it was kind of like, well, I like the name. It's catchy. You know, people gravitate towards the middle, so I'm fine with it. You know, it's great. So that's kind of been the journey to getting into oyster farming. And there are other ways that you can get into it. Like, I can sell one of my leases, and all of the ones that I have are a lease from the state. And it's a 10-year lease term, but it's essentially property that can be transferred. So I can sell that. You still have to meet requirements, and the state essentially can take it from me if I weren't meeting those requirements, or if something happened like water pollution, it's a huge issue. If pollution were to spread so that whatever the bacteria colony count is, they can say you've reached this threshold, we're gonna have to shut this lease down, you're no longer allowed to harvest from it. That can totally happen, and in New Hanover County we see it, you know, everywhere we see it, really, that's coastal. But as you move north, it's lessening. But it's been scary watching the development progress north from Wilmington and south from Jacksonville. And if you haven't driven up to like Holly Ridge or that area up off 17 in Hampstead, it is incredible how much open soil there is right now with new development that's going in. Just unbelievable. So that's a huge issue and a concern for longevity in the industry, and that's obviously a trend that's probably going to continue. There are some watershed restoration management plans that we're working with the Coastal Federation with to try to help. However, that's kind of retroactive, and the problem exists, and unfortunately, trying to mitigate that after the fact is very challenging, and sometimes, you know, you're not going to be able to capture all the pollution that's created. So. Scared as far as that goes, but you know, we're charging ahead full steam. And worst case scenario, my assumption is that maybe I won't be able to sell an oyster for human consumption, but maybe it'll be a oyster that either we can get some kind of nutrient credit or some other kind of credit that would help, because the oysters, they filter, you know, an adult oyster, they say can filter 50 gallons of water in a day. So that's a lot of water for one little oyster, you know, 12 oysters over a 5-year time frame, that's a million gallons of water, which is impressive. And then you think about these little farms that you know, are popping up all over the place, like what we've got, and you've got, you know, 500,000, 5 million oysters. Now, they're all in various stages, and probably most of them are pretty small, but that's a lot of filtration capacity. So then there's also a bunch of habitat benefits from that. But so we currently have six leases. One's in New Hanover County. It's the only water column lease in New Hanover County currently. I think there's two bottom leases, but in 2019, there was a moratorium that was put in place over New Hanover County and Bogue Sound, and then there's one that's been in place in Core Sound for a long time. I'm not sure when that went into place, but it's 30 years, I think, and I think it's a 50-year moratorium. But they put that in place due to what they refer to as user conflict. And there was a guy, his name is Hormos Gudarzi. He was the, I think it was Scarless Vein Care guy, or yeah. So there was a farmer who got a lease through the state, and this is what I was talking about. If you have enough money, maybe you can get a submersion land claim. Was paying taxes on his property, and the property boundary went from the shoreline all the way out to the ICW, but there was a big bay there. But you know, the state, they granted a lease right on top of his property boundary, essentially. And there was a couple pages, full page ads in the Star News that were talking about how bad oyster farming is. The guy was like, it looks like D-Day out there, the beaches of Normandy, and just like, oh, it was crazy. Just nonsense that he was saying. But he was really loud about it, really vocal, and he had enough money to kind of portray it in a negative light. And maybe, you know, you can also look, also the oyster farmer himself maybe could have done a better job of being a liaison and going and talking to the guy and, you know, tell him what he's doing and maybe tightening his gear up as best as he could, that sort of thing. So you can see both sides of the story there. But ended up that the state, there was a lawsuit against the state. The state lost. The guy had to move. So he's up in Stump Sound now, and I think he's also expanded into a couple locations, Topsail and I'm not sure where else, but he's a pretty big player too. Soundside Oyster Farm is the name of that. Tom Cannon, who ended up getting kicked out of Masonboro. But so right now we've essentially got exclusivity for selling a Masonboro oyster. So fantastic for me. And since I'm grandfathered in, the moratorium is on new leases. So it's no new leases. So fingers crossed, unless pollution ends up causing there to be a closure boundary that covers the farm, we'll hopefully continue on, and I think we've got 5 more years or so on that lease before they would renew it. So we'll cross that bridge when we get there, but it's exciting to be able to have that.
So how long are the leases for?
10 years right now, and you're limited to applying for up to 50 acres is one person or entity can have, and you can't apply for more than 10 acres at a time. So it's an interesting thing. I know guys that have applied for, you know, 5, 10-acre tracks right next to each other to get there as much acreage as they can. And it's kind of like, well, it would have been a lot easier if you just said, okay, here's a block, versus having to submit 5 different applications, and each one has to have corner posts to mark the boundary and things. And it's kind of like, you could have gotten away with putting a lot less PVC or whatever out in the marsh than ended up what they had to do. But so that's sort of the progression that we've taken to get to be able to be an oyster farmer. The first couple years, we started out pretty small. The first batch of oysters that we put in the water was around 36,000. Sounds like a lot, but now we're planting, you know, 250,000 at a time. And you can buy an oyster essentially at any stage, because what we buy is called a triploid oyster. So a triploid oyster, you may ask yourself, what the heck is that? Well, it's talking about chromosomes. So we're all diploid organisms in here. We have 2 sets of chromosomes. And the way to think about it is seedless grapes and seedless watermelons. You know, they're bred so that their offspring produce a grape, an oyster, or a watermelon that only puts energy into growing regular cells versus gamete cells. So it's not putting any energy into growing sperm or eggs. It's only growing bigger and it's growing faster. So for me, as an oyster grower, I want to get that oyster as fast as I can out, because there's hurricanes, there's disease, there's droughts, there's so many things. Crabs, anything you name it, loves eating oysters, and they're a pretty hardy animal, but they're also pretty, you know, susceptible to a lot of things. So those organisms, you can buy them from a hatchery at essentially any stage you want. You can buy them as larvae and set them yourself. You have to have, obviously, lots of tanks and things like that to be able to do so. Or you can do what we do. We buy them that are at a pretty small size, around 4 millimeter. At that size, they cost around a penny and a half. And then from there, we grow them out, and we have different bag sizes and corresponding mesh sizes to reach all the way up to essentially once they're big enough to sit inside of that largest mesh bag. That's going to be the final grow out bag. And the biggest bag size that we've got is 18 millimeters. So lots of flow. There's a guy up north that has a equipment company, and he says, the more flow, the more grow, the more dough. So So, and we wholeheartedly agree with that, because, you know, the opening of a bag is actually, it restricts the flow significantly. And so you want to get that oyster into that next size mesh bag as fast as possible. And then not only is it going to restrict it, even if you had a clean bag, but you got to think there's barnacles and tunicates and algae and just so many other critters, sediment that gets on that bag and ends up causing it to, you know, shrink that hole down a little bit, so the flow is reduced. We typically start out with around 10,000 oysters in a bag, but 250,000 oysters is coming in an onion bag that's like this big, so not very big. So you know, you're putting ounce wise, it's probably an 8 ounce glass in per bag, and then
I'm sorry to interrupt.
No worries, anytime.
How many in a bag, and how big is the bag?
Like, well, I've got an example outside, right outside on the right next to the porch. Okay. I brought one of the cages that we use. We have a couple different gear types. The bag is probably this tall. It's a rectangular shape, and it's like this big, somewhere around maybe 3 feet, polypropylene, high density polypropylene. But you can take a look at them outside. I've got a cage that we grow. It's Oyster Grow. Is a Canadian company. That's probably the majority of the gear that we have, and that gear was designed for growth in Canada, so the wintertime they can sink that to the bottom to get it out of ice flows. But we use it down here to sink it for hurricanes. So in case that comes, we can sink it to the bottom, and it doesn't, you know, guarantee that they're going to survive, but it gives you a much better chance than if they're on the surface and floating around. So there's an example out there. Definitely, you guys should take a look at it. It's got a 2 millimeter bag, a 4 millimeter bag, a 9 millimeter bag, and an 18 millimeter bag. And that's most of what we do. We have sixes and 12s, 14s as well, but that's the majority of what it is. And you can see the progression. The 2 millimeter bag essentially looks like screen porch material. Very fine, it's very small. I mean, the oysters are super small, so. And then that small hole gets clogged so fast in the summer months, so you really have to, we'll scrub them with a brush and that sort of thing. And the idea is you really want to get them out of that bag as fast as possible. But so from there, essentially, once you're moving them from one bag or another, I can take him, Steve, if you want. So when we move them from the bag to the next size class, we'll take them and tumble them through a machine. The machine, it might show up on there, is a long tube. It's about 8 feet long. It's at an angle, and it spins. It's the same principle as a trommel for separating out rocks and sticks from dirt. So these oysters spin. There's a small hole at the highest point, and then a larger hole. And so the smaller oysters fall out that first hole, and then corresponding size classes fall out that next largest hole, and then at the end. And we also have two different tubes that have two different hole sizes on them. So we can take them and separate out the smallest oysters to begin with, and then separate out the largest ones. We typically have been handling them around 12 times as far as like taking them out of a bag and then putting them back into a bag. A lot of that is due to using minimal gear. So essentially, you can pack a bunch of oysters into a bag, and if you leave them there and you didn't do anything to it, more than likely they're going to start growing together or getting a little ugly and not be in the shape that we want. Our target market is for the white tablecloth restaurants, so we want high-end, perfectly round, identical, consistent product that the chef can chuck out and they look real pretty on a plate. When we first started growing, we produced an oyster that was probably on average around 4 inches long, which is a large oyster, and you're very, very deep cup with the growth that the method we use and the tumbling that we use. We've cut that down now. We typically sell them around 2.5 inches long. Most people that I talk to that are local around here, they want a bigger oyster.
Yeah.
But there's a lot of people that don't want a big oyster as long as it's got a nice deep cup. They're eating it raw, so they like just a basically a little bite, and the chefs really like it. And we hear some people that'll complain, oh, these are too small. But there's a lot of people that, either we don't hear anything about it, which, no news is good news, I guess. But For us, it makes more sense as a business model to sell them as small as we can. If nobody, you know, if they're not upset about it, then why would we hang on to it for another 6 months and have the possibility that, you know, some of it's going to die or whatever might happen could happen. And if, you know, the turnover rate as business model is way better to do it that way. So we try to sell them at 2.5 inches. Now we have the golden, I think, ratio is 3 inches long by 2 inches wide by 1 inch deep. And our oysters are around there, you know, it's each one of them, they're kind of like a snowflake. They're all individuals and unique. So we try as hard as we can to force them into that, nice ratio there. But, for the most part, they're all a little bit different. Right now I've got 4 people that come out and help me. It varies week to week. As Steve mentioned, I still work for him part-time. Last week I was in Fort Lauderdale. I did a coral relocation project for him, moving corals to the University of Miami from a dredging project. They were going to get buried. But now I get to pick and choose because other projects aren't so nice. like diving in the Cape Fear River. It's getting ready to happen for an archaeological study. Not interested in that. it's great to be able to pick and choose a little bit. So right now, last year, every year, we've sold more oysters than we have, and we've grown it pretty slow. Working full time, 2 babies, wife, full business owner. It was pretty slow to get it up and running. It was a weekend warrior type situation. And then we, with the multiple farm locations, so we've got the one in New Hanover County, one in Pender County, and 4 in Onslow County. And for the most part, we've got 2 in Onslow County that are active. The other 2 are sort of, I grabbed them because I saw the writing on the wall and it was a land grab. So it's like, I want to be able to expand into the future. And we're doing a little bit of, we're trying to get a project started with the Natural Resource Conservation Service, where we're trying to deploy Shell. It's a cost share program. Problem is, it's kind of an unknown, and marine contractors are really expensive. And to be able to get the shell, the amount of material that we need out on the lease is going to be, I think, maybe prohibitively expensive. Hopefully not. We're still pursuing a couple options. But by having all those leases, it ends up being a huge time constraint because each one essentially needs, depending on how big it is, at least 1 full day, if not multiple days. And so, the reason why we did that, though, is because there was an author, Rowan Jacobson. He's a chef, I think. He's an Austriophile. He wrote a couple books on oysters. I think he has one called The Essential Oyster, and it talks about oysters all over the place. But he, in that book, The Essential Oyster, is quoted as calling North Carolina the Napa Valley of oysters. And so it's the same principle of Napa Valley with the different geology and sediment types that have an influence on the grapes that influence the wine. It's the same exact principle to an oyster. An oyster is what's called an osmoconformer. So it's not regulating its internal pH for the most part, or internal chemistry really at all. And so if you take an oyster from one place and stick it in another, it's going to take on the flavor profile of the waters that it's sitting in. How long it takes before it would really be acclimated, I don't know, but essentially, each small creek or water body is going to have its own set of environmental parameters, whether it's like close to a creek or far away from a creek, close to an inlet or far away from an inlet, really sandy bottom, high energy, or really low energy and a muddy bottom. And all those factors play into what that oyster's eating and the salinity content. And so that flavor profile, you know, for me, there are definitely differences in some of the leases during certain times of the year. Like, say, Stump Sound, typically it's pretty salty, but it'll be less salty than Masonboro. And so that salt flavor for me is like the biggest difference that I can detect. Now, there are other people I'm sure that have more sensitive palate that could probably pick up a lot of other subtleties. But it's kind of like wines, you know, like there are some people that can taste the wine and say, oh, this was from this region or whatever else. Me, I'd be like, yeah, that's a red wine for sure. that diversity in leases, not only does it give us options to be able to sell essentially multiple products, and each one of our leases or areas, we have a branded oyster. So in Stump Sound, we sell an oyster card called the Tar Heel Tide Runner, and that's probably like our flagship oyster. We sell the most of those. And Stump Sound is kind of renowned. If you're from this area, you've probably heard of it, or if you like oysters and you're from this area, you've eaten it.
Is that in Pender County?
Onslow. Yeah, just beyond. I think there may be, basically Stump Sound is from the 210 bridge that's Surf City up to the 210 bridge that's North Topsail Beach. That's like Stump Sound proper, but water doesn't stay in one place. So it's moving around.
And you said you have four in Onslow County, one in New Hanover.
And one in Pender.
That's what I thought.
Yep. And so with that diversity, with the effort that goes into it, it's worth it because we have what's called shellfish closures, rainfall thresholds. Yeah, so we get a certain amount of rainfall each growing area. The state has blocked off all the water bodies in areas that are going to be similar hydrodynamically. And so the idea is each one will have a different flushing time. So how much fresh salt water is going to come in, oxymoron there, and exchange out so that there's enough or there's not the bacteria levels that could make them unsafe for human consumption. New Hanover County, at least where my lease is, B6, is 1.5 inches of rain within a 24-hour period. If it rains that amount in 24 hours, we're automatically shut down. There's a proclamation that's sent out to us that says we've reached that threshold, shut down. The state will then come out over the following week or two, and they'll sample the water. And then they take that back, they culture the bacteria, or they do some method. It's not a culture, but they do some method where they take a look at how much bacteria is there. I think they use Enterococcus and another one as a proxy to coliforms. And from there, they'll say, oh, we haven't reached that threshold. We're going to wait a little bit longer before we open you. And then eventually, assuming you don't get more rain or it clears up, you get opened back up. Actually, I think maybe Masonboro is 2.5 inches. Stump Sound is 1.5 inches. So Stump Sound, where we are in B9 growing area, is only 1.5 inches, which is not that much water, you know, considering the amount and energy of the storms that we're currently seeing and the increases in that energy and the rain that we're seeing. It's really not that much rain. And the last couple years with the drought conditions we've had, although it's been great to be able to harvest oysters, have actually been deleterious to the oysters themselves. Last year, around May, June, we lost almost our entire crop in Stump Sound, like almost all of them. And it wasn't just us, it was all across the state. And I think we were down like 25 inches or something like that of rain. So just an unbelievable, you know, catastrophe essentially. But that's part of farming, whether you're terrestrial or aquaculture or whatever, you're slave to the waters in this case. So so there's heavy metals. There's a lot of unknowns. I'm a member of North Carolina Sea Grant Executive Board, and I just got some proposals in looking at some contaminants. Study that was down in South Carolina. I think they're going to try to reproduce it here in North Carolina. Really, it's bacteria. Those are the biggest ones. There's these bacteria, specific bacteria. Now, all these bacteria are naturally occurring bacteria. They're in the water. It's the same bacteria that if after a storm you were to go out and do some yard work after a hurricane and you're in like puddles of water and you have a cut or something, that's one that could kill you. It's just out there. The problem is the oysters are filtering 50 gallons a day. They're better than a Brita. and so they can concentrate whatever it is that they're grabbing. Now they'll eat a bacteria, but they'll also pass it. The problem is when you take that oyster and it's in the process of either eating it or passing it, and you grab it out of the water, it just clamps shut and that bacteria is inside of it. And bacteria growth at 60 degrees is exponential. So it doesn't have to be that warm for it to be all of a sudden, you know, a couple hours from now, that's a problem. And that's why, you know, typical oyster season, for multiple reasons, but one of the reasons is in the summer months, oyster season's getting ready, wild oyster season's getting ready to end. I think it's either March 15th or April 15th, I'm not sure. But that's wild caught season closes from there in the summer all the way to October 15th. And so the old myth is that you can't eat oysters in the summer because it's a month. Yeah, you can eat an oyster. It's got a month with an R in it, which is an old wives' tale. Because, you know, back in the day, people didn't have refrigeration. And so if you take an oyster out of the water and you let it sit outside at 90 degrees, you know, it's not going to be good for anybody if you waited 5-10 hours to eat it. So, and there's also the regulatory side of that, like the fisheries management. Oysters can't run away. They're just out there. They're not like a clam. You can harvest clams year round. It's kind of like they're pretty much eating the same stuff. Now they're typically buried in the sediment, so they don't have that thermal stress. But oysters can't run away. They're right there. They're exposed. Everyone can go get them. They also spawn. They start spawning right about as they close the season. And so it's a more of a management thing is why they have the wild caught season and close it down during the summer months. For us, since we're growing a oyster that we're putting in our bags, and we have what's called a time to temperature requirement. So when I pull an oyster from the water in the summer months, which I think they define as basically the off season, I have 5 hours. So once I get it out of the water, the clock starts. From that 5 hour time, I have to put it in mechanical refrigeration. Can't be ice for whatever reason. The state says ice is not good enough, but it has to go in mechanical refrigeration. And from that point, 2 hours after that, you have to have it down to 50 degrees. And then you have to maintain it less than 45 degrees. If you go above 45 degrees, depending on how long you catch it, there are things that you might have to, you may have to just dump the product, or depending on, like, if it just went over 45 degrees for, you know, an hour or something like that, that's not really a big deal if you can get it back under control. They will allow you to put ice on them at that point. If your refrigeration unit went down, you can get ice and salvage your product. Bacteria is definitely the biggest one. Vibrio, there's a couple different species of Vibrio that are really bad. And that's why there are consumer advisories. You know, if you have health issues or immunocompromisations, like you don't want to eat them, or maybe you do, but it's playing Russian roulette, because although you can do whatever as a farmer, like obviously I would never want to sell an oyster that would get somebody sick, but it can happen. You know, you can do the best with your ability. Maybe that oyster shut down for something else. There was a high concentration of something going on there, and you don't know it, and you pass that along to a consumer. Or through the cold chain of custody, I give them to a chef. Chef sits them on his table. They stay out on his table for a while, and then they get put away. Or I give them to a delivery driver, and then he doesn't have his machine correct, or he shuts his machine off, or it sits on the back of a loading dock, or any number of things that can happen. That could potentially be issues as far as increasing that bacteria load, because I would guarantee that there's bacteria in each one of them. It's just a matter of concentration. And so, consumer advisory.
Question. So, is the state coming out to each of your leases and specifically sampling at your site? So it's their own, so their sites and their.
I asked them to come out, but they said they won't do it. Which is interesting, because I was like, it makes more sense. Obviously, there's a lot of leases now, so they can't get them all. But it makes more sense to open the water body based off of where my farm is.
Right.
Especially now, that's wild-caught, too. So wild-caught guys, and that's why they do it. And they have a long-term program, and they have specific sampling sites that they've visited. I don't know how long, years and years and years, probably 50 years. And so that program is kind of, not the bread and butter, but that's what they do. And then this is shellfish sanitation through the Division of Marine Fisheries. And they'll come out and sample these other locations to try to reopen the water body. And they've got multiple sample sites that they'll go visit. I believe they just took on a new employee last year, but it used to be one guy from South Carolina all the way up to Moorhead City.
Yeah, I know that guy.
Matthew?
Yeah,
yeah. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know, it would be cool if we could find some funding to sample within your space. And
yeah, absolutely.
The water,
I'm on board.
Yeah. but I have another question. How long does it take from
About a year. It's about a year. And that's probably from when I get them. But it totally depends on the seed stock. So getting into genetics, right? So there's multiple. So here's an interesting thing. So we're talking about triploids earlier. So that's a product that is spawned. They either chemically induce or they use a pressure to induce a normal diploid oyster to convert it into a tetraploid oyster. They take that tetraploid and spawn it with a diploid. That gets your triploid. So here we are with the triploid genetics. Now, genetics, like anything else, they can, when they spawn, they can overproduce and get a narrowing in the genetics. And you get a kind of a bottleneck. And there's been big issues where they keep spawning the same oyster and you get inbred. And then you have a bunch that start dying off and there's no other logical reason. And you got pathologists that are looking at it and they can't tell you anything other than, yeah, that's a dead oyster. It stinks. when I buy them, I've been buying them at that 4 millimeter size the entire time I started. It's the most economical for us because you can get a lot of them for a pretty small amount of money. You have to assume a certain fraction of that is not going to grow. And it's a big bell curve, right? You're going to have 10% that are extremely fast growers and getting huge, and they'll be ready in 9 months. 6 months if you're selling a 2.5-inch oyster. And it depends on the time of the year, right? Because, you know, you put them out now, and it's getting ready to kick off. There's so much pollen in the water, those oysters are going to be eating good. I don't know. I would assume so. I would have to assume so. It's got to be the right size, and they're eating, you know, microalgae, so they've got to be gorging on that. But oysters that I planted in October of this past year, I bought them at a 4 millimeter. They're not even 6 millimeter right now. Mm-hmm. So all winter long, they basically have essentially been in a suspended state of animation. They haven't really done much. The problem with me purchasing that size seed, we call them seed, is I'm buying them from a nursery who's buying them from VIMS, Virginia Institute of Marine Science. They're the ones that have, with another company called, I think it's Triple H, they have the patent on the breeding technology. And we pay a 15% royalty every time we buy seed. Doesn't matter where from, they're the only ones in the country. That's something that is really disappointing, and I wish that there would be a university that would jump on board and kind of crack that, because 15% is a lot when you talk about millions. So when I buy oysters at that 4 millimeter size, I hope that what they would do is they would, because it's the same process that I do to get the larger oysters graded out, just on a small scale. So they have little tiny mesh screens, and they typically have them in hold, like raceways, holding them with water being pumped into it. And I don't have any evidence of this other than what I've seen on my grow outside, but once you sieve that top group, that's your best grower, right? Whoever gets that is gonna be really happy. Then the next group, sieve that out. That's still gonna be a really good group. Third, great. Fourth, not so good. Fifth, sixth, getting kind of bad. And so what I've noticed from a couple growers in the state or nurseries in the state, I won't mention any names, but I've had product that typically, if it's a good spawn top cull, it's gonna be really hard to control the shape because it's growing so fast that you really have to shake it up and tumble it up and keep the density super low because it's just gonna explode in your bag, especially this time of the year if you plant it right. However, and the opposite is, if you get a really slow grower, that shell shape is going to be immaculate, and it's going to be deep, and it's going to be like a golf ball by the time you get close to the 2.5 inches, but it's going to take you 18 months, and sometimes longer than that. We have a certain percentage that we end up just dumping, because after 6-8 months, it's still less than 0.5 inch. It's like, okay, that's either going to be fish food, or it's going to be part of the wild population now, you know. So we've had a problem with that, and we're trying to figure out a way to rectify that this year. I've talked to some of the nurseries that I've had issues with and told them the problems that I've had, and, you know, it's very obvious to me what's going on. The question is, will the nursery either implement a program that says, okay, I'm gonna spawn, or I'm gonna buy a really small oyster and rear it, and then cull it three times, and then everything else, the dregs, is just going to be a loss? Or are they going to continue and just keep adding to that dregs pile, and then eventually they're going to be big enough to sit on a 4mm screen, and then they're going to sell it? And it's kind of like, it's a poor business model, in my opinion, because I quickly transitioned to other nurseries. You know, we could buy it from out of state. You got to get an importation permit to check for diseases and stuff like that. But unfortunately, I've had issues with the nurseries in state, so I've transitioned and moved out and bought it from out of state. But I've also had issues from out of state nurseries, so it's not like it's something that just happens here. I went with Oyster South. I don't know if anybody's familiar with them. They're kind of a nonprofit Southern oyster advocacy group. They got a symposium this upcoming weekend down in Savannah that we're going to go to. They have a program called the peer-to-peer program, and they allow you to go and visit another farming operation or nursery operation or some other operation that you can learn from, you know, hands-on experience. And I went down to Tampa Bay and kind of piggybacked a trip down there and visited the biggest hatchery in the state down there. And he really enlightened me on a lot of those practices. And what he does is he culls them four times max. And after that, it's a new spawn. And he just does volume. He's got these, he's got multiple buildings and these giant, you know, tanks. It's just unbelievable when I walk through it. And some proprietary equipment for essentially like bioreactors, so big light structures to grow the algae to feed to the oysters. But he was really enlightening to talk to because it was basically a confirmation of what I was seeing. And so other than the business practices of the individual that owns the nursery, that's sort of, you know, you're not really going to be able to combat that, because when somebody hands me an oyster, I have no idea how old it is. I just have it based off the size. You can look at the shape, and the shape gives you a little bit of information, but it's not the whole picture. It's only a little part of the picture. You really know at the 12-month mark or 18-month mark, and you're like, yep, that was a runt. We're not going to get any bigger. We have been utilizing a lot of our shell, especially with this big die-off that we had this last year. Everybody in the area, I mean, you're talking hundreds of thousands of oysters that died off that were market-ready, essentially, so about that 3-inch mark. We utilized that on a couple of our leases to plant that shell for hopefully catching wild set and that habitat. And a lot of it is like, well, you're just going to cull that out of your bag anyways. So I would take it back home. And in Masonboro, I built a couple nice reefs. Hopefully we'll see with this. We're going into the time frame where there's getting ready to be a lot of oyster settlement. Spat fall is what they call it, oyster spat. And so hopefully those reefs really take off. And I think Masonboro is an area that they consider it. It's not spat limited, so tons of oysters. I'm imagining that they're going to explode. We actually, when I was at the university, there's an area that's just maybe a half a mile away, and we built a bunch of these reefs, and we tried to look at, do you need to seed the reef, or do you let it go naturally, and what will be the outcome there? And in the area where we were, there was so much spat fall and settlement that it made no difference because there was just that much out there. But an area like Stump Sound is completely different. It's only, you know, an hour north from where we are, but completely different, spat limited, more shallow subtidal, and typically a lot less recruitment. Now, it's been interesting. I had an oyster farmer tell me when I first began, he's like, one, you're not really an oyster farmer until you've killed a million oysters. and two, you know, you won't know your lease for 10 years because the environment changes, the climate changes, and you're going to get drought years, you're going to get wet years. And I have to say, he's totally right. You know, we've learned a bunch. We started off really small. We, you know, learned a lot by going small, you know, learn big. But have 100% seen in 2017, 2018, those were really wet years. I mean, I think in 2018, we were closed more often than we were open, which made it really challenging and was another reason why we sold real big oysters that year. Couldn't sell them. But the last 2 years have been drought years, and we have had very little rain, and we've got the marine community that's infiltrated into Stump Sound. And so 100% the community has changed. And there's, you know, still sediment, still a lot of the same creatures, but creatures that we didn't see before. We had a bryozoan set that just was unbelievable. And it's really fibrous and blocks the flow and was on everything. And so that was really bad. And who knows if they may produce some kind of chemical that also contributed to the die-off that everybody saw. But 100%, when the salinities shift, that's when you're going to see the different communities. And that biofouling community is really quick. It'll come in, you know, given the chance, a couple of weeks, and you got oyster, barnacles all over your oysters. And that's something that we also really try hard to prevent, because barnacles on oysters aren't pretty. And at the end of the day, it comes down to how they look on a tray, you know, on a sheet of ice. So, and also, like, you know, it's a shelf life thing too. Like, you want to knock all those barnacles off, because those barnacles are going to die before that oyster does. And typically you'll get a couple weeks. I tell people to eat their oysters when they come pick it up, try to eat them within a week. But really, they're probably good to 3 weeks or longer. Yeah, do you have a question? So on the West Coast, the pH of the ocean water out there is getting more acidic. And they're having a huge problem with setting their larvae. I'm not sure exactly what it is, but 100% the ocean acidity is causing there to be an issue with that initial set. Once they get set, it's okay. They typically are hardy, and they can pull enough calcium from the water or carbon from the water or CO2 to be able to get the calcium they need in their shell. But it's really that initial set that was extremely terrible. And there were a couple of seasons where these guys, Taylor Shellfish Farms, were having huge problems with their settling, and they had to basically treat their water to increase the pH to be able to set them. So they're super resilient group, you know. Oyster farmers all are super resilient, have to be, otherwise you wouldn't do it. It's terribly hard work. You gotta love it, it's a labor of love. Around here, I don't know if there's been that big of an impact. I haven't really heard much. I would think that it may reduce the amount of, you know, how fast they could accrete their shell, essentially. But we kind of look at it as like, that shell is like long-term storage for CO2. Now, people don't really talk about it that much, but that shell is going to last a very long time. And so growing lots and lots of oysters is pulling that CO2 out of the water. So I don't think they get enough credit. The amazing oyster. I'm biased, but it's definitely, like, as far as like an environmental sustainability thing, there's no other greener protein production on the planet. None. You know, we don't feed them. The water's cleaner when you leave it. It provides habitat for fish, shrimp, crabs, you name it. May not look great, you know, in some people's eyes. There's a big thing, NIMBY, not in my backyard, where people are like, I don't want to see it. Now that there's bigger or more farms and a lot of them, I guess, there's been a big push, I think, for people not really wanting to see it. And part of that is change. You're always going to have difficulties in change. People don't like it. Part of that is maybe ignorance, you know. I was told, I didn't go to this, but I was told there was a meeting on Tuesday, I think, that was a public hearing meeting for a bunch of new leases that was held in Sneed's Ferry. And I was told that there were a lot of fishermen up there just up in arms saying how bad it was and how that scares away all the fish and, you know, all these other things. And it's kind of like, well, come on out to the farm, man. I'll show you the redfish swimming by, you know, that we catch and the little crabs and the little shrimp and the little fish and the snapper and stuff that we see all over our cages. So I think there's some misconception there. There's also the issues with change, and there's also, people just don't like the looks of it, and it's new. So I think it'll probably end up being something that's, as we move forward, there is and has been a constriction on what they're going to allow. Like, obviously, New Hanover County, they put that moratorium in place, said no more. There's too many people here, too many other users, user conflict there. We'll see more of that, I'm sure. There's a question back here.
Yeah,
pea crab? No, that's a pea crab. That's its own species, yeah, and that's the female. Myself and a PhD student that was in the lab have a publication on the pea crab. It was, yeah. There was only one other publication that we could find, and they only had an N of one. So we were like, that's low-hanging fruit. With as many oysters as I shucked in my master's thesis, I was like, and so many crabs that we were pulling out, it was an easy little thing for him to kind of take that and run with it. So that was great. I flick them out personally. Do you eat them?
I do like
yeah, a little crunch.
They're edible, right?
Yeah, oh, absolutely. Yep. I see people, they take them out, the raw ones, and just let them sit on their tongue, and oh, it's dancing on my tongue. It's kind of not for me. I flick them.
Mm-hmm. Do you sell yours to restaurants by the bushel?
Everything we do is by the count.
By the count?
Yeah. So
I'm confused because, like, if I buy a bushel from Harris Teeter, they give me 100 oysters.
Mm-hmm.
If I buy a bushel from Eagle Island,
But
a bushel used to be.
Is a volume. A bushel is a volume. Yeah. It's 8 gallons, I think.
Gallons.
Or, no, it's 10 gallons. Okay. 2 5-gallon buckets.
Yeah.
But if you Google a bushel, it'll say it's 100 oysters.
So,
yeah, and so if you think about it, a bushel is a volume measurement, so it's based on the size of the oyster, you know.
By the count.
We buy them by the count, or sell them by the count. We count every single one of them that leaves the farm, 150,000 of them last year. So
is it 100 count for your restaurant?
Yeah, yep. Typically, our counts are 100 count bag,
okay.
And we'll sell anything that somebody wants. Like yesterday, I had somebody pick up 24. I typically kind of sell them at like 25, 50, and 100. And then from there, you know, multiple hundreds. If somebody's going to do an oyster roast, that kind of thing. But yeah, by the count. And each one, like I said, hand counted at the moment. We tried to get a grant this past year. We were denied, but we had some equipment that was going to help with counting and stuff like that. But
yeah, that's intense.
Yeah. Because it would have streamlined some things. And mm-hmm. It's all right. We'll keep counting. It does vary. I'll be going by catch today. Green gill oysters. You mentioned that. So anybody know what a green gill oyster is? Green seafood. It's not green eggs and ham. Green gilled oyster. Yeah, a couple years ago, the phenomenon happens not every winter, but most winters in certain locations on a fairly frequent basis. Last year it happened in April for 2 weeks and was gone. Over in France, they have what they call fin de clairs, super popular oyster known throughout France. And when it goes green, they call it fin de clairs verde, I think, yeah. And it's celebrated. And it's called Haslia, is the algae complex. And it's multiple algae species. But each one of these algae produce a pigment that's a green, blue-green pigment. Depending on the concentration of the algal bloom, those oysters are filter feeding. They're eating the algae. The algae is staining their gills. They'll get depending on the concentration, a minute olive drab type color to a turquoise blue, unbelievable coloration. And right now, we have that happening right in Stump Sound. I don't have any video of it. I would show you.
I think that was an article in Star News a couple weeks ago.
Yeah, cool. Yeah. I've got some photos. Maybe I could send them out. So right now, they're green gill, celebrated. So that pigment is called myrinin, and it is one of the most potent naturally occurring antioxidants on the planet. So eat oysters for your health.
It's on the outside of the shell.
Not on the outside.
Oh,
it's the gills. It stains the gills, which the gills of the oyster also are the filtration like apparatus. So right now it's amazing. They're beautiful. They look fantastic on a plate. So we push them hard. But a couple years ago, it used to be nobody would eat them.
Right.
They're like, something's wrong with my seafood. It's green. Who wants green seafood? So Blue Point, I think that's a New York oyster. Yeah, that's, I believe there's a place in New York called Blue Point. But it's been, not to say ripped off, it used to be like there was one specific place, but now there's and it got a name for itself because it had a great quality oyster, but now it's like a, a big area, region. So there are multiple people that'll sell a Blue Point oyster. It's.
And you mentioned you were starting to talk about the restaurants you sell to. Mm-hmm. You mentioned Catch. Any others?
Yeah, Riceville Beach Brewery, typically pretty consistently. Manna, we're the sole supplier of oysters for Manna. Pinpoint, used to be Tidewater Oyster Bar, Elijah's, the Pilot House. Most of the restaurants in town that sell raw oysters, we've sold to, whether that's directly or through a distributor. We have two distributors we use. We don't have any control of what the distributors do with the product after we get it to them. But there's one one's called Inland Seafood. You'll probably see their trucks rolling around town. They got some box trucks and, you know, real pretty logo, real wrapped up, looks great. Their headquarters out of Charlotte. There's actually a couple like headquarters, but they're multiple regions, same company, but this regional area, they go to Charlotte. So they'll take my oysters, they come pick it up from my refrigerator, take it to Charlotte, where their warehouse is, then they truck it back here to deliver it to the restaurants. Inland Seafood.
You said that you had brand name oysters. One was Tar Heel Tidewater. What are you other?
Masonboro Pearl.
Oh, cool.
Named after my daughter.
Right.
She couldn't make it here. She's over in Charlotte today. And then we've got the Top Sail Top Stone.
Oh, wow.
And then for the green gills right now, although they're it depends. Earlier in the year, the algal bloom occurred in Masonboro, which I've only seen one other time, but it was green enough to market them as a green gill oyster. And when they turn green, no matter which location they come off of, like right now, they're in Stump Sound, but I call that the Carolina Jade. And so, most growers that I know have a branded product, and they change the name based off of whether or not it's got green gill or the location they harvest it from.
You said Masonboro Pearl
Top Stone. Carolina Jade.
Cool. I missed this. I'm sure you said it at the beginning, but did you learn about oysters from UNCW?
Yeah, that's right. Yeah. So when I first started, we did a lot of oyster reef ecology. So we would go out to an oyster reef, and the reefs around here are all intertidal. So we would grab, you know, a little tiny quarter meter squared area, pull that back to the lab, stick it in the refrigerator, a bunch of them all across the reef, and would look at the fauna associated with that, look at the number of oysters associated with that, look at the size of the oysters, demographics. Sometimes we would do the sex of the oysters. Those were in a lot of the tidal creeks around here. Then from there, when I first started working for Steve, I went down and did deep water horizon oil spill work, and that was looking at hydrocarbons in a lot of the oysters and some of the shrimps and stuff like that. And essentially, at that point is when basically I decided, I still worked with Troy Alphen at the benthic ecology lab a little bit, and came back and was like, you know what, the writing's on the wall. There's getting ready to be a lot of oysters produced. I think Noah said, you know, we were going to need to, essentially replace 50% of our wild caught industry over the next few years. So it's like, well, you know, the trend is there's going to be more consumption. We're going to need more of it. I can get behind it because it's environmentally friendly, and it's on the water. You know, so all the things that I wanted. So we jumped into that, it's been, you know, nonstop oysters. Steve also does a lot of, he does so many biological resources all over the place, gopher tortoises, coral reef, seagrass, you name it. We do terrestrial stuff as well. But oysters have always just been, you know, I don't know, they fit me. We got a couple. Yeah, have you ever heard of a living shoreline?
Yeah.
So that's something, now depending on what type of living shorelines, because there's multiple types. Typically they involve some kind of hard substrate, and that would provide sediment for oysters, and that would provide the filtration. But then they also have typically a plant component, like Spartina grass or Spirobolus grass, and that would also help with sediment retention, which also could help with filtration. So there's a lot of these living shorelines or sanctuaries that the state has started to implement. Not many sanctuaries, actually, and I've got a real bone to pick with the state on that, because the closest sanctuary from here is in the Cape Fear River, which is great and all, but let's face it, Cape Fear River is a little bit of a lost cause at the moment with all the chemicals and things that are in there. Still, well, thinking about consuming oysters from it, I don't know. Like, it's up to you. Yeah. 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 Well, I think they're probably everywhere, unfortunately. But that's one. Great. I'm all for it. Anytime they'll put a sanctuary in place, absolutely, it's fantastic. But the closest one from there is up in Moorhead City, or just north of Moorhead City towards the Pamlico. So why there aren't any down in the lower, you know, higher populated areas where you could arguably say you'd have the most impact from keeping oysters from being able to be harvested, they keep saying it's a user conflict issue. There's not enough space. Clearly, there's enough space. I've pushed hard on it. Unfortunately, my name is well known with the Division of Marine Fisheries, not necessarily in a positive light, more of a thorn in the side kind of situation. But those sanctuaries are definitely probably the closest thing to what they put down for filtration. They're also using it because oysters that are there are spawning, and they're going to be a little island where they can spawn, and their larvae are floating off. Lots of different reasons, habitat, that sort of thing. There's a company in Maryland, I believe, called Blue something. They are trying to develop nutrient credit-based oyster aquaculture, which I think, like I was talking earlier, if one of my leases were to get shut down, it's 100% potential that the county or whoever that is producing lots of nutrients could purchase nutrient credits based off of how many oysters we would produce. Now, that's kind of far-fetched at the moment. You know, I don't see that happening in the next 10 years or so. It's definitely a possibility. And there's also a restoration component for people that want to have, instead of a bulkhead, they want to do a living shoreline. You can produce oysters specifically to be able to put out in somebody's waterfront property. And recently, the Coastal Area Management Act, CAMA, has made it easier to get a permit to do so. Used to be you had to do a CAMA major permit application, which is a pain and, you know, really lengthy process, kind of expensive. But they've made it more simplified so that you can essentially go out and do it yourself with little permit costs. But those are the kind of the couple things that we would do with it.
Mm-hmm. There was a lot of limestone bags instead of oyster shells. Mm-hmm. I remember there used to be oyster shell drop offs.
Yeah.
And then they shut down. Are those reopened and are they using them? Is somebody managing like your waste, like when you had all the death?
So we could take the oyster shell recycling program, is what you're talking about. Yeah. So they did shut it down. I don't know if that was a political stunt or something, because it came right back. but so. They've got them all over the place. If you look it up, they've got, you know, just oyster shell recycling. They got all the locations. There's one right at Wrightsville Beach, a couple of different locations. A lot of the shellfish houses will have them. But yeah, that's a great thing. You unfortunately have to rely on people bringing it to a site. And after you do an oyster roast, you got stinky oysters that you got to then have to separate out your trash and everything else. So a lot of people end up just throwing it in the dumpster. For us, I just use it myself. Because I have the potential to harvest that oyster in the future. And I know as a scientist and as an aquaculturalist, like I'm out on the water and I see where there's gonna be a good place to start building a reef. Now I'll do that on my own lease or adjacent, but I've also known guys who will take it off their lease. And at that point, you know, you don't really have any control of it anyways because you're out in the public trust water. So somebody, if they wanna come and steal it, they can do it. It's not really much you can stop them. But if you put it off your lease, you don't have any protections to say, hey, don't take that. You know, I built that or I grew that or whatever. But yeah, 100%, that could be used as a restoration component, or if you wanted to, you could take it to a recycling center, and then Coastal Federation can either utilize it or Division of Marine Fisheries can utilize it. But 100%, we're shell limited in our abilities to be able to do some of this restoration work. And that's why they're using alternate substrates. Marl, concrete, asphalt was used in Maryland, and then there was a lawsuit to get that pulled back out. That I think that's not, you know, not allowed here. Concrete was just placed on the approval list of materials. Question is, how do you get clean concrete, you know, crushed concrete at the right size to make it worthwhile to put out? But it's cheap, super cheap. So, you know, I guess as far as any substrate out there, because oysters, although they prefer shell, are not that picky. You know, you see them on dock pilings and everything else, you know, any hard substrate, they'll settle on it. They get down to that last week of being a plankton and they're floating around, and they get a little desperate, so they'll settle on anything. But yeah, so definitely shell is super limited. Jessica here was talking about trying to get some programs. Coastal Federation's big in on it. Hopefully, you know, I talked to my restaurant partners that we utilize and asked them what they do with the shell. There's a few that will essentially use a couple 5-gallon buckets with lids. They put all the shell in that bucket. Once it gets full, close it off, they put it out back, and then they just have multiple buckets that they'll run at a time, so that way they can the grower can utilize it. I'm not sure what they're doing with it. I imagine it's some kind of oyster reef they've got that they built personally. Other guys, Pinpoint Restaurant, there's a, I guess he's like a commercial composter that will take it and they compost it, and so that's used terrestrially. I'm not sure. Probably. I don't know. Because I every time I'm, you know, every time I get a new restaurant that I've never dealt with before, I ask them what they do with it, because it is a limited resource and they need to know that. Because like the whole aspect of the environmentally friendly side of things is to, like, hey, you know, got to be a steward too, and give people the information so they can make the right decision, or hopefully.
Saying to them, I'll pick it up, you separate it?
I have. Typically, though, they say, oh, well, we you know, we have a recycler, or they do some recycling, but a lot of them just throw in the trash. Yeah, it's right. Just one of these,
so
like.
That's the problem.
I was involved in the VCU sponsored oyster recycling in Chesapeake Bay.
Okay.
General area. And it's very simply volunteer based.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, you aggregate, right? So you get 100 people picking up two 5-gallon drums and taking them to the bins.
Right.
Right. You said there's one at Wrightsville Beach right near mm-hmm. the Coastal Federation location. So that's all it is, really.
Right.
It's just getting enough people to go once a week and picking up one 5-gallon or two 5-gallon bales from a restaurant.
Right.
Yeah.
So
can you start managing that program?
Yeah. Sounds like a volunteer. So some of that can be mitigated through, you know, if we had a consistent route. So manna, for instance, every week I'm delivering, same day, pretty much there, pretty much consistent amount of oysters. That's one that would easily be able to scoop up and say, okay, I'm going to come pick up these shells once a week. Some of it is location, like, and the smell. Although you can put it in a bucket, and I don't know how bad it would be, you know, probably be fine. But a lot of those restaurants downtown don't really have readily available space to store.
Frequency.
Yeah.
Frequency of pickup.
Yeah. Yeah.
Some work for Coastal Federation, and this is the project I'm working on, and I just started. That's why I wanted to talk with you particularly. But I'm going around to restaurants in the area in the southeast region and finding out what are they doing, any that serve oysters. And I found, just anecdotally, what got me onto this was I would go to certain ones and they'd say, oh, we used to recycle them, now they go in the trash, or they're on the oyster trail and they don't recycle them, or, you know, just a lot,
right?
You know, so trying to get that. And my understanding is the state had provided a lot more of these recycling bins, but then the money stopped for that. So it used to be a little bit easier. That's why some restaurants are saying they used to recycle, now they don't. So we're trying to figure out, how can we make this happen?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I'm still a little bit unclear. So you're needing shell from the recycling program, right?
Yeah, so if I can get the program that I want to deploy, it's part of the Natural Resource Conservation Service, USDA program. That's
yeah.
a cost share program to essentially help farmers deploy a new method, or this specific program is like the rare and declining habitat. So essentially it's like if I were gonna plant loblolly pine or something like that terrestrially, but this is for oysters. There's a rare declining community. So they say, okay, this was an approved community to essentially do a cost share program with. The problem is finding a contractor that is willing to do it in a least expensive manner, because although I'm all about sustainability and building oyster reefs, at the end of the day, I'm also a businessman, and I don't want to spend $100,000 on putting a bunch of concrete out in the water and then possibly not have it be fruitful for me.
Well, the tough thing, because oysters, the shells are sharp,
mm-hmm.
they smell, and they're heavy.
Yeah.
So it's obvious, I mean, it's sort of obvious, but are you getting these recycled? Do you need shell to keep growing?
No, yeah, so when I buy an oyster, I'm buying an individual oyster, and it's essentially what they call a cultureless oyster. So it's an oyster that cultures just ground up oyster shell, and they grind it to a specific size. They get a single layer and distribute that over a silo. It's kind of, you know, probably depends on what you, where you're going, but they put water, it's a downweller, so they push water in there, and it forces water past each one of these little tiny pieces of shell, microculch. And the idea is it's small enough so that only one larvae, one baby oyster larvae, will settle on per piece of shell. And so then you sieve that off after a week, and everything that's bigger than what was sieved originally is an oyster at that point. And then from there, it's just an oyster, and it's making its own shell. And you'll get doubles and triples and things like that. But we pretty much don't sell those. We will sell a few. We try to break them all apart. Sometimes you lose an oyster. A lot of times we'll just, you know, give it back, you know, let it go. But yeah, all of our oysters are cultureless oysters, so we don't buy any shell. Now, we're sort of, I don't know if you want to call it modern farming, but we're sort of using techniques now that weren't used just a few years ago. A lot of that was due to the availability of hatcheries and nurseries. Like, there weren't that many that were producing it, so you just couldn't get it. But used to be what people would do is called oyster gardening. And there's a program, the state, they still do it. It's not that many people that do it. It's called the Oyster Relay Program. And essentially what it is, at a certain time of the year, if you're a leaseholder, you are allowed to go into certain polluted tidal creeks, and they take oysters, live oysters, clams, and shell from these creeks, and they transfer that out to their water column or lease area. And then they let it sit there, and after 6 weeks, I think, or maybe it's 12 weeks, they consider those to be clean of pollutants, and as long as your growing area is open, you can harvest it. I got a lot of problems with that program. I raised a lot of cane, was told that it's not a big deal, told by all sorts of folks at the state that it's really not a big deal, that there's no problems associated with it, and there's plenty of regeneration back. But the way that I look at it is that these are the front line creeks, the front line of the pollution problem, right? So you want all your biological filtration right there at that headwater. And so I asked them, I said, okay, so you're allowing people, it's essentially sanctioned by the state to go take all this resource out, public trust resource, put it on your private water body, and then you're growing it to be able to make some money. There's an issue with that alone, but why aren't they being required to take shell back into these creeks? They should be mandated that if you're going to participate in this relay program, you have to go back in with shell and replace it. And then it could be sort of a, you know, reoccurring thing. And their argument is, oh no, it just keeps reoccurring. And it's like, well, that's not the case. You know, 100%. Like, I've seen it, some of these creeks, after some of these fishermen go in there, the fishermen are underestimated. I'll say that. They're good at what they do, you know. So you can talk to your face is blue, though, and it doesn't really matter. They keep saying it's not a big deal. I even tried to make a point to say, okay, well, what happens if, hypothetically speaking, my farm is adjacent to another farm? The farm next to me, they relay. They shut that lease down. It's by proclamation. They say it's polluted. Can't harvest it. What about all the mud and contaminants that they just dumped in the water and they're flowing in my farm? Hypothetically speaking, you could have just polluted my farm and prevent me or cause me to sell a contaminated oyster. She didn't really have a great answer for that, but she said that wouldn't happen. And I was like, you know, you don't have any study. I was like, no, that's not true. Like, she's like, well, that's going to go down to the bottom. I was like, what about sediment suspension, resuspension by waves or something like that? Like, it's totally plausible. You know, just because you haven't studied it doesn't mean that it doesn't happen. And it probably is a scale thing. Like, if somebody's going and getting, you know, 100 bushels and dumping them in, then that could be a lot of pollutants, you know, especially considering those tidal creeks are the forefront of the majority of the inland pollution. So I'll get off that topic because my blood pressure is getting a little high just thinking about it. But so that's a program where they could really utilize some of that shell material.
I'm going to pause us right here. We are at about 10:15. So I think if you can hang out a little longer, that'd be awesome. And if you guys have further questions for James, you can hang out. I did forget to ask you all to put your name down on our sign-in sheet, so this will be on the front table. If you didn't, if you could put your name on this, that'd be great. And we also have a donation jar out front, too, if you're feeling generous today. This video that's been playing behind James as he talks is a show that you were featured on.
Mark Weens is a videographer, vlogger.
Mark Weens.
Yes. If you're into food, the foodie, he's an amazing guy. He travels all over the world and eats all kinds of amazing foods.
Yes,
tons of chefs, yeah.
It's a 1-hour series, and we will share out the link in our e-newsletter so you guys can watch this whole 1-hour feature with audio included. But we will keep coming, and we hope to see you again in the future. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you. That was awesome. Hunter fell asleep, I see.